teenage girls screamed for him as he gyrated across the stage. But three women who knew him best say the movie tells only part of the story of the life and wild times of one of the kings of rock and roll. They paint a picture of a man who could be both sweet and cruel, sensitive and a total pig. A poet given to rages, an artist ravaged by drugs and alcohol, and obsessed with death. Patricia Keneally may have known him best. She married Jim Morrison almost 21 years ago in a witchcraft ceremony that was both bizarre and not legal. It also never got in the way of his rambling, debauched lifestyle.
It was Jim and myself and the high priest and high priestess of the coven. The two participants make cuts in their wrist with the ritual dagger, and the wrists are bound together with a ceremonial cord. And you drink from a grail of consecrated wine after you've dropped a couple of drops of blood into it. When he wasn't drunk, he was this other person. He was Jim. He was this tender, loving, sensitive, gentle person with whom I was very much in love. And when the alcohol was around, he was the pig man. I could see him be incredibly cruel to all his friends. It wasn't just to me. It was to, you know, other people that he was involved with. It was to the other Doors. It was even to his fans, I suppose, on occasion. His audiences, certainly.
Judy Huddleston met Morrison in 1967 when she was just 17. They had an on-again, off-again affair for 4 years.
He was gorgeous. I mean, he was gorgeous. And I just fell madly in love with him, just totally dumbstruck. He was really an artist, and he was really looking for the truth, and he was really sweet, and he was really a creep, and he was like a full human being at each end.
We want the world and we want it!
She says their love life was a wild roller coaster ride.
It was good and it was bad. It was both. It was real exciting because it was really alive and it was really amazing. And sometimes it was like one of those romantic fantasies if he was in a good enough mood. And sometimes it was like a nightmare, though.
She remembers his cold, dark side.
My dog had been run over, and he had been really sweet about it, like over the weekend. And I saw him, and he said, he came back, and he was real drunk, and he said something, well, we all have our run-over dogs, just in this really cold, and it just, after he'd acted like really caring, and it just, you know, it was awful.
Kitten Not-To-Be-Dodd was 19 when she met Morrison in a Los Angeles nightclub where he often drank himself under the table.
He liked women that teased, and he liked glamorous women. He wanted women that everybody was, you know, looking at.
But Kitten says the constant boozing mixed with drugs often made Morrison a less than satisfying lover.
A lot of the girls would say that he'd get on top of them and then he'd fall asleep. He would just, like, you know, kind of like want to touch, and then kind of passed out.
The face in the mirror won't stop.
The boozing and all-night cruising made a shambles of his life. Controversial author Albert Goldman investigated Morrison's mysterious death and blamed it on a lethal mixture of booze and heroin.
He was often involved in violence and accidents, cracking up his car, stuff like that. He was the most extremely self-destructive person. In fact, my sense of him is that he aimed to live a short but extremely interesting life.
He self-destructed, basically. He didn't put a gun to his head or anything, but it was certainly the alcohol that got him in the end.
Patricia has seen the movie twice and gives it mixed reviews.
It's not the Jim Morrison story. It's the Oliver Stone Jim Morrison story, which is not bad. It's wonderful, actually, but it's not the whole thing. You see Jim the shaman, Jim the lizard king, Jim the out-of-control alcoholic.
That's the Jim Morrison people remember most, and that, his old girlfriends say, is part of the tragedy.
Was a terrible waste, a personal waste for me, for him, an artistic way through everybody else.
He was supposed to be standing up for all his ideals, and then he turned around and copped out by dying. You know, did the whole exact cliche.
In his art, he had a preoccupation with death. In his personal life, I suppose the alcoholism was soaking up all that, so to speak. We talked about it. He didn't seem to be particularly afraid of it. It was another thing to break on through to.
When the music's over, turn on the light.
When the music ended, suddenly in a bathtub in Paris in 1971, there was no time for goodbyes.
If I'd had a chance to say goodbye to him, I suppose it just would have been that, you know. Goodbye, good luck, and best of luck in your new location.
Bring on through, bring on through.
That film about the Doors opens around the country tomorrow. Should make quite a splash. And we've got lots more rock and roll coming up for you.